Amen. Praise God. So be blessed, receive, and we know we're going to leave this place here filled with the Word of God and the presence of God. God bless you, Phil. Amen.
How's everybody doing? Everybody doing good? Hope everybody is enjoying their Wednesday. Hope you guys enjoyed worship. Amen. Spending time with God. Very excited. Appreciate you guys tonight. Very excited for what God's going to speak. I hope you guys are as excited as I am. If you're not, then get out. Don't be here. Leave. So, but anybody here for the first time? Everybody here has been here? We got everybody that's been here? All right, cool. Well, welcome. I hope you guys enjoyed this night. I hope you guys are alert and attentive of what God plans on doing tonight. Tonight, I want to talk to you guys about no holding back. Tell your neighbor if you can. Just tell him, be like, I'm not holding back. No longer holding back. Amen. No holding back. Well, as we know, life is a journey, right? You know, everybody says that life is a journey of a million miles and it starts with one. You know, it's, it starts with one step or what so be it. But life in and of itself is a journey, right? But as you know, like when you're younger, right? When you're younger, you're so excited about life, right? You enjoy life more when you're younger. For some of us, hopefully we all can have a life that when we're older we can enjoy as well. But it seems like there is a carelessness about being young that when we're older, we don't really have that. And we call it responsibility and maturity. I'm not here to disagree with you. I'm just saying it's what we call it. Right? But life is a journey. And this journey, if we are not careful, can be a journey where as we get older, the older we get, the more we settle for mediocrity, right? The more we settle for doing what pays the bills, and that is a very, very important thing and something that nowadays we cannot live without, unfortunately, but it leaves us wanting. It leaves you lacking something, doesn't it? It leaves you questioning your every motive, your every action. It leaves you questioning, why are you putting so much effort into something that you don't like? Just to pay bills? And at the end of your day, if you're like me, you may even get a little stressed out because life wasn't really what you thought it was when you were younger. Now, I'm going to share tonight about what God thinks about this and how God intended life to be, because for sure, God did not intend life to be lived in mediocrity. The Bible even says that life is meant to be lived to the full, to the fullness. So there is something to say that life is not meant to be lived in lack. It's meant to be lived in expectancy of fullness, greatness. Something good is going to happen. Always living with that expectation of good, and not only an expectation of good, but knowing that there's something good that you can look at even in the midst of your situation right now. Because God wants you to live full. We're going to look at this verse. We're going to jump right in it. Are you guys ready tonight? You guys ready to jump right in it? You guys ready to amen and get in this? I hope you guys are. I wasn't convinced, but we'll see how the night goes. All right. So open your Bibles to Matthew 19. I'm going to start at verse 16. Matthew 19, start at verse 16. I'm going to read it in the New King James. Verse 16. Now, behold, one came and said to him, good teacher, what good thing shall I do so that I may have eternal life? So he said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good but one, and that is God. But if you want to enter into life, keep the commandments. Well, he said to him, which ones? Jesus said, you shall not murder, don't commit adultery, don't steal, don't bear false witness. And then the man looks at, or honor your father and mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And then the young man said, I have done these things since I was a kid. I've been keeping these things since my youth. I've done them all. Give me something else. And then Jesus goes and says to him, well, if you want to be perfect, if you want to do everything. Go and sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and then come follow me. When the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possession. Will you pray with me? Lord God, Father, I thank you for these moments that we have together. Lord, I thank you for your love, your grace, your mercy. I thank you for what's happening in this room, what is happening within us, God, that we take these moments and not take them for granted, but enjoy what you're doing tonight and what you're doing in us, God. I thank you for each and every life here, Lord, and I think that tonight will be a powerful message and that you would minister to our hearts as we get along with the night, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Amen. So a little bit about me. I am a very, very forgetful person. I would even say that I'm probably the most forgetful person in this room, and I'm only 22. So I'm very, 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 very forgetful. There are only a few birthdays that I can actually remember, and one of them is my brother, and the only reason I can remember is because one years back, his birthday was on 666. So that's the only reason I remember his birthday, and sometimes I think he's a spawn of Satan, but he's not. But nonetheless, it was weird. So... but that's one of the few things I remember. I'm not good with dates. I don't remember my oldest brothers. I don't really like them that much, so I don't have to remember it. But I don't really remember. I don't remember my mom's birthday. I remember some years I don't. But usually people remind me of my family members' years because they know better than I do. So I'm very forgetful. Because I'm very forgetful, I tend to lose things easily, misplace them. Right, that thing that they say, trace your footsteps. Well, it doesn't work if you don't remember your footsteps. Right, it doesn't work if you can't remember where you stepped. And that's my case. Right, but I never wake up and say, I'm going to lose this on purpose. Right, I don't say and wake up and say, you know what? Today, I'm going to lose my wallet. Today, I'm going to lose my keys. I don't lose on purpose. It's just something that I do because I'm forgetful, and I don't put things where they belong. I just like throw them there somewhere, and then that's why they get misplaced. Don't look at your husbands, please. So anyways, but that's how I am. But I don't lose on purpose. And I kind of relate with this guy, this rich young ruler. He doesn't go to Jesus expecting to lose on purpose. Actually, he goes to Jesus... A, because he's feeling good about himself. Right? He's first of all, he's rich, so of course he's going to feel good, right? So he's rich, just to start. He's a ruler, which is even better, right? And he's actually, if you can, based on religious law, he's actually, if you could consider, maybe an even righteous young man. In religious leaders' eyes, he would consider this kid pretty righteous. Right? And if you look at his life, you'll say, man, God loves that kid. He's rich, he's a ruler, he follows God's law, he's blessed, look at him, right? So, but he wasn't expecting Jesus' response, right? He went to Jesus, and he goes, what am I lacking? Right? It goes to say that the works and the rules and the things that he kept since he was young, the good deeds, it left him lacking something. He didn't feel full. Because if he felt full, he wouldn't ask Jesus what he was lacking. But he felt like he was losing something. Kind of like us sometimes. We feel like we're missing something. That we feel like we should be the happiest people on earth, but for some reason, we're lacking something. We're lacking joy, happiness, desire to do things, meaning in our lives. We're lacking things. And Jesus' response is something so impeccable because Jesus goes right for where he knows this man's weak. His possessions, what he has. He says, give up everything you have. Lose it all. Lose on purpose. And then come follow me. So basically Jesus hits him right where it hurts, right where he's weak, and right where he won't have an answer to justify himself. Which goes to say about Jesus is not a cruel man. See, one translation even says that Jesus looked at this man not with contempt, but with compassion. Jesus felt with him. He wasn't looking to prove him wrong. He was actually looking for this man to find meaning in his life and to know where meaning was. And church, if we are not careful, we focus too much on our perfection instead of the perfection that is among us in Jesus. We lose sight of the perfect one because we are so focused on our perfection. God is not asking you to be perfect. God is asking you to be willing. God is not asking you to keep a list of commandments just to say that you've kept them. He's asking, are you willing to follow me? Are you willing to lose everything? Are you willing to give it up? Not a little, but all of it. Churches now in the 21st century, it's predicted from 2012 to 2014 that between 10 and 12,000 churches will close. Between 10 and 12,000 churches will close in these United States. Not this one, amen. But it goes to say that there is something that is lacking in churches that we forget, because church is not about only entertainment. Church isn't just about you coming to a church where there's, you know, great music and good-looking people and lights everywhere and it's always a party every single service. No, if we're doing that, we are missing the mark. Right? Because in the end of the day, what Jesus is looking for is just a willing heart. And he echoes this in Matthew 16, 24 to 26. I'm going to read it in the Message version. It says, then Jesus went to work on his disciples. Very glad that God works on us. He went to work on his disciples. Anyone who intends to come with me has to let me lead. First off, God's in the lead. He's the lead. He's in the driver's seat. You are not. I am. Don't run from suffering. Embrace it. Follow me and I'll show you how. Self-help is no help at all. Self-sacrifice is the way. My way to finding yourself, your true self. What kind of deal is it to get everything you want but lose yourself? What could you ever trade for your soul? So Jesus basically echoes here that losing your life is the key to finding your life. Leaving the care for your life, just like you did when you were a kid, is the way that you gain back the fullness in your life. I think that's why Jesus is so keen on us having childlike faith. That faith that restores the happiness, the joy that comes in Christianity, not the somber and depressing Christianity that a lot of churches possess today. No, God's church is meant to be alive and well, fully functioning, healthy, and happy. A happy place to be. But because of us struggling with keeping everything, struggling to being the driver's seat, struggling to get our way, still holding on to things, holding on to whatever we're holding on to, when God is asking us to just let go. Let me be in the driver's seat. Let me be in control. When you lose your life, you're going to breathe a new fresh air. When you lose all regard for yourself and live for me, you're going to lose that somber and depressive state that you were in, and you're going to gain meaning for your life. See, because the older you get, the world kind of says that you got to grow up quick, be mature, you got to pay your bills and work in jobs that you don't really like just to get by, where God's message is not get by. God's message is one that you thrive. God's message is one that you soar. That you go above mediocrity. That is the message that is preached all throughout the Bible. But if we're still holding on to ourselves and holding on to what we think we should do, holding on to, just like this rich young ruler, the commandments and doing this and doing that and our own responsibility, we're messing it up. We're losing the view. It's funny that this young ruler had an opportunity to experience real Jesus, to experience Jesus right in his midst, but instead he had to walk away sad and depressed because he could not find the strength to give it up everything. See, if you're not really captured on this, we're not trying to trick anybody into Christianity. Right? Because if we try to trick people into Christianity, some point in their Christian life, they're going to get disappointed and they're going to pretty much leave church, just like I've seen many, many times, because we give a fake view of what Christianity is. No, Christianity is one that you have to lose it all, and not everybody's prepared to do that. Not everybody's prepared to give up everything. I sure am not. I struggle with this just like this rich young ruler, and sometimes I leave looking back at Jesus like, really, dude? I'm going to give this up. Are you serious? So there's a struggle in Christianity, but the preaching here is not that you're not going to have to give up everything. No, the preaching here is that when you receive Jesus in your life and you receive this life of salvation, it's going to take all of you. It's going to take 110%. It's God, you giving your all to God. Right? It's you understanding that when you get into this life of salvation, you gotta give it all. It's literally all or nothing with God. It's literally, I'm gonna trust you with everything or just nothing. Because there is no in between. In between is mediocrity. See, in between is lukewarm. That's what in between is. In between is a life where you go back and forth, where you have no steadiness, you have no commitment, you have no longevity in your relationship with God. Your relationship with God is up here, or sometimes it's down here, because we are not prepared to give it all. But as I see around me, and when I see people who are really, really on point in their faith, I see what they had to go through. That they one day made a decision to give it up, and how God provided. When they just said, God, I'm going to let go. And God provided. God made a way. And that's what God does for us. He doesn't just say, let go of everything. Give up your whole life. And then fend for yourself. You're on your own, buddy. No, that's not what God does. That's not the story of the gospel. The story of the gospel is one that says, hey, you know what? You're going to give up everything. But what you're going to get back in return is what you will never have experienced if you would have never given it up. What you're going to get in return, you could never have imagined it possible. But because you gave up everything, I'm going to show you what real Christianity is about. And real Christianity comes when we're prepared to give it up. When we're prepared to lay it down. And it's a process. Laying down is a process. It's not something that you're doing one day. You're not going to leave this place and say, God, I give it all, because you can't. It's a process. But nonetheless, a life of surrender is one that each day we take what we are holding on to and surrender it. And it may be a process of a lifetime for you to really get to a place where you're able to surrender everything. But when you take that step of a lifestyle of surrender, you're going to see how God honors that. How God honors a willing heart. How God honors a heart that goes beyond everything. That goes beyond what you even thought were possible. Right? The reason a lot of times where we don't have this place filled is because we need to see people giving up everything and seeing how God responds to that. But if you don't give up everything, you're robbing yourself of a testimony that God can use you of. See, if you're not ready to prepare to give up everything, a lot of times it's a false misrepresentation of what Christianity really is. And Christianity, yes, it's not about how God will bless you. It's about just giving it up and doing it for the love of Jesus and for really knowing Jesus. But in the end of the day, God does honor that. God will bless you. God will do something that you cannot imagine. And people need to see that, because they need to know that God is powerful. That God is still alive. God is active in the church. The church is not dead, and nor is it dying anytime soon. Amen. And people need to see that God is living. That God is active. That God is working. But God works to the proportion that you allow him to work. God works to the proportion that you let him into your life. If you're leaving some doors locked and closed and lock and key that not even God can open, then you're not going to allow yourself to experience the fullness that God has for you. And God has this fullness prepared for you. See, the deception that Satan wants to put in your mind is that when you obey God and you give it up, that God won't provide. That's a deception. The deception is the fear of giving it up and being disappointed. The fear of going all in, putting your heart fully into it, and being left hanging. That is the fear. That is what we all face in an everyday life and journey in Christianity. God, if I give this up, will you be there for me? God, if I give this up, will you lead me through? God, if I give this up, will you take me where I need to be? Would you give me this fullness and satisfaction that I'm longing for deep within? This is the fear that all of us have within us. And unfortunately, that fear can only be quashed when we actually do it. When we just trust God and say, you know what, God, I may not have the answer. I may do this while I'm fearing, but I'm still going to do it. I'm going to give up everything, and I'm going to trust that what you give in return is more than what I can ever imagine. That me losing my life is not going to be a regret. I'm not going to regret giving up everything. I'm not going to regret losing my life. I'm not going to regret giving up everything I have for the faith to do what God has called me to do. I'm not going to regret that. And that promise is inscribed all over the Bible. That God will not forsake you. God will not leave you. God will not let you go. God paid the ultimate price. Why would you think he will let you go now? It's inscribed all over the Bible that God is a provider. He's a Jehovah Jireh provider. God the provider. So never when we give something up that God won't provide for us when we give it up. And mind you, these are always things that take the place of God. Right? The rich young ruler wasn't struggling with something that was easy to manage. No, it was something, his possessions, that were taking over the place of really knowing God. That's why it was so hard to give it up, because he depended so much on that. So it's not just giving up something little, it's something that is taking the place of knowing and experiencing God in fullness. That's why it's so difficult to do. But God has a promise behind it that he will always come through when you do that. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Amen. So basically, losing your life is where you find it. Right? Losing everything that you have and losing your well-being, your own well-being for your life, doing what you think is best for yourself opposed to what God thinks is best for you, that's where you really find life. There's literally a song by Hillsong United that says, I found my life when I laid it down. In other words, I found my life when I lost it. I found out what life was really about when I lost it. Right, but what is life about then, right? If it's not about our own successes, because apparently it's not, because this guy had everything he ever needed, was a ruler and he was rich, and still left his life with less meaning and even lacking something. So if life isn't about possessions and what we have, what is it really about? What is Christianity about? What is going to drive us every day in Christianity? What's going to lead us to this fullness that we deeply want to experience? Because if it's just about possessions and what you get, there's going to be a moment that you're going to give up everything and you're going to feel like God has forsaken you, but he hasn't, but you will feel that. And if that is the case, if it's about possessions, you're going to feel that God disappointed you. It's not about possessions. It's not about what you get in return. It's not about being in the limelight. It's not about being in the spotlight. It's not about being big or famous. It's about one thing. And we're going to go through that right now. If you can turn your Bibles to Philippians 3:8. In Philippians 3:8, this is Paul talking to the church of Philippi. And right before this verse, Paul literally gives a list of all his accomplishments. Like, he gives a list of everything good that he's done. Right? He's an elite man in a tribe of Judah. He's a very elitist. He's a guy who keeps his religious principle. He stands up for his convictions and beliefs to the point of even stoning Christians. That's how religious he was. He was circumcised on the eighth day. These are things that religious leaders back in Jewish law, they looked in with awe. This guy was like everything to them. He was a big deal. But look what Paul says with all that. He goes, yes, indeed, I count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish that I may gain Christ. Amen. You know why giving up is meaning? Why giving up is so meaningful? Why losing everything has purpose? Because on the other end of that, it's what it's really about. Knowing Jesus. That's it. See, when we think that giving up is going to lead you to worldwide acclamation and fame, you're misguided and misleaded. Right? If God wants to lead you there, amen, God bless you. But giving up your life is to find somebody else's life, Jesus. You lose your life to gain his, to know him. You surrender your life so you can know more about him. That's what Christianity is all about. That's what Christianity has always been about. Knowing Jesus. Knowing his sacrifice for you. Knowing what he did for you. Knowing that there was purpose behind what he did for you. Knowing all about his love for you. Knowing about his grace, his favor that's upon you. It's all about knowing Jesus. That's where the fullness comes from. That's where the excitement, the joy. The more you know about Jesus, the more you fall in love with him. But it's giving up everything to know Jesus. That's it. Right? I don't want anybody to come to church and think that it's about something bigger than it really is. No, it's just about knowing Jesus. If I want people to get an idea of what church is about, it's about coming to church and knowing more about him. I want this community to exude knowing him. I want this community to be all about knowing him. It's nothing else. It's Jesus and nothing else. He's at the center. He's at the forefront. He's at the spotlight of everything we do. It's just Jesus. We have no special formula. It's just Jesus. It's just him. In Colossians 2 through 4, I'm going to read this in a message. It's amazing what this says here. It says, I want you woven into a tapestry of love, in touch with everything there is to know of God. It's in the Message version. Then you will have minds confident and at rest. Focus on Christ, God's great mystery. All the richest treasures of wisdom and knowledge are embedded in that mystery and nowhere else. And we've been shown that mystery, which is Jesus. And I'm telling you this because I don't want anyone leading you off on some wild goose chase after so-called mysteries or the secret. There's no secret. There's no get Christianity quick scheme. There's no get prosperity quick scheme in Christianity. No, there is no scheme. There is no plot. There is no trick here. There's nothing that somebody has that you don't. No, it's just about knowing Jesus. There's no get-rich scheme in Christianity. It's just knowing about him. It's about being confident and at peace that as you know him, you find rest for your soul. You find rest for your being. You find rest and confidence that he is doing something amazing, but that comes from knowledge of Jesus. Just knowing him. Just knowing more about him. Knowing about everything he has for you. Falling in love and friendship with him. And God, when I look at that man, I wish I was there because I know how much my life is lacking because I haven't given it all and I haven't sacrificed everything just to know him. Because when I was a little kid, I got this get rich or the secret scheme, thought that I was special, thought that I was something that I wasn't, where it's not nothing about that. It's just knowing Jesus. Man, how I was misleaded and misguided. It's always been about knowing Jesus. And if you're not satisfied with knowing Jesus, you're going to leave dissatisfied with Jesus. If Jesus is not the centerfold of your life, you're going to get mildly disappointed in your faith. If Jesus isn't the thing you wake up for, if going to his word and spending time with him and reading your Bible and being in prayer and not doing it just to do it, but doing it genuinely, from a place of need, from a place of desperation, if that is not what you're all about, you're going to live a Christian life that's dissatisfied. If that isn't enough. Because Jesus is more than enough. He should be more than enough. That's why a lot of times you look at people who kind of don't even go to church and it seems like your problems, like compared to theirs, are massive. right? Like people who are not even going to church or spending time in the faith. This is an exception for some people, of course. But for the most part, it seems like Christian people get the brunt of it more than people who don't go to church, right? It seems like people who don't go to church, like you're like, man, wow, okay, cool. You know, well, why God? But that's not the case. I think the thing is here is that when you're so used to living in mediocrity, you got no real scare. Like if you're not doing anything that is threatening to the enemy, you're not going to really be tampered with, right? But the enemy loves to go after the people who are getting somewhere in their faith. He tries to discourage and get people down, those who are actually going somewhere, who are actually living their life and giving up their life for Jesus. He doesn't go for people who have nothing to do with Jesus or want nothing to do with Jesus because they're not a threat. God or the enemy goes for where the threat is. But if you're not a threat, you won't be tampered with. Right? But the more you get to know Jesus, and the more you get to know that you already have victory in him, you don't really fear of that. There's actually a big painting on my wall in my room, and it's like this warrior dude, and it says, victorious warriors, they don't go to war and then win. They already win before they go to war. Right? And that's kind of exemplary of our Christian faith. Like, even though it may feel like you're losing, which is the only thing you should be losing is regard for your life, regard for what you're holding on to, and letting God take care of that, letting God be in the driver's seat. You just be in the back seat chilling and let God be in the driver's seat. But it's even more peace to know that as you get to know God and get to know him more, you start to find out that, wait, why am I stressing for? Why am I worrying about this for? I've already won. Right? The victory is already mine. Everything that I ever wanted is already taken care of by Jesus. And that's what it means to really get to know him, to know that you don't have to be in the driver's seat. You don't have to have it all figured out. You don't have to have all those answers. You don't have to know anything. Release the burden from yourself. You don't have to know everything. What you need to know is Jesus and Jesus and Jesus, and let him take care of the rest. But when you put the burden on yourself to make something of your life, you're going to be dissatisfied. But when you relax and rest that Jesus is providing and opening doors that you can never have imagined in your lifetime, that's when you get to relax. When you get to enjoy life because you know that there's another person with greater power, greater measure, taking care of your life. Amen. Opening doors that you can never move. Amen. Opening doors that you had no key to. We are winning this battle one way or another. If it may seem like you're losing now, take a look at your life and see what God wants you to let go. If you feel dissatisfied and you feel if you feel like a nothing, or you feel like you're nobody right now, or you feel like you're way over your head, take a look at what God wants you to let go. Take a look at what you're holding on to, because God wants to give you rest and peace. This isn't a message of conviction. This is a message of God's great love for you. This is a message that you letting go leads to a satisfied and content life. And not content in mediocrity, meaning content in Jesus. God has so much more for you than you can imagine. If you're not looking at your life and amazed at Jesus, there's something wrong. If you're not looking at your life and you feel like you're lacking something still, there's something wrong, because that's not the life that God has destined for you. I have one more verse that I wanted to share, and it's actually a story. So in the beginning, we talked about, you can come up, Caleb, if you want. In the beginning, we talked about how this rich young ruler, he was struggling to give it all, right? But there's a story, right? And it's pretty much one of the initial things that Jesus did in his ministry. Really, like, popped out of nowhere, and people like were like, well, where's this guy? Right? Where did he come from? Well, he was in where the fishers in the port of the sea, where all of the fishermen go. And everybody knows the story pretty much. The fishermen were toiling at night, which later became the disciples, Peter, John, and James. They were toiling all night. They were fishing all night. That was their day job. They weren't nothing much. They were just fishermen. They weren't like this rich young ruler. They didn't have possession. They didn't have money. They weren't holding on to anything. They were just regular old, like you and me, fishermen. right? Just trying to make a day's living, trying to get life going on, just trying to make it by, nothing special. But when Jesus gets into the picture, right? They've been working all night, working hard all night, struggling to catch anything, struggling to make ends meet, right? Maybe feeling inadequate or feeling a little bit maybe down about their life because of the way things were going, and Jesus steps into the picture. They don't know this guy. For all they know, they could be a crazy guy talking to him. But Jesus just goes, look, go back in there. Go back into the sea. Go back. Lay down on your nets again. And when they go back and they actually listen to this guy, I bet they maybe even thought he was annoying and were like, okay, fine, we'll go back. But as soon as they went back and they picked up everything that they had such a great load, such a big catch of fish that the nets were breaking at the seam and they had to call all their fishermen to help them carry the load in. But what messes with me in this story is not that God actually provided, because that's a given, but the response that Peter, James, and John and other people there had. See, when Jesus went away, they left everything behind and went to go follow him. They didn't even question it. They were so amazed that Jesus did what he said. They were so amazed that Jesus was who he said he was. They were so intrigued by this guy that they didn't even focus on the large catch of fish that just came boiling in. It's as if like they literally just won the lottery, and they were so amazed by Jesus that they literally just left the ticket there. Like, it's crazy. But they were so amazed with Jesus. They were so fixed and focused on Jesus that the possessive things and the possessions that they wanted, that they were toiling all night for, really didn't seem that important anymore. And I think that's what happens when we get a view and focus of Jesus. The things that we once thought were important become less important. And what really becomes important is following Jesus wherever he may go. What really becomes important is chasing after this Jesus wherever he may go. And not worrying about what you're going to lose. Don't worry about what you got to give up. If you think about that now, you're not going to have strength to do it. This is a God thing. God is going to give you strength to do it. Just like the verse says, he says, let me do it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to take care of you. Don't even worry about that. What I want you to be focused on is just me. Don't focus on what you're going to lose. Don't focus if it's going to be worth it. Don't focus if it's going to be worth everything you're giving up. No, just focus on me. Let me show you what this is all about. Let me show you what this Christian faith is all about. And I think when we get to really know Jesus and know his love and see him for what he really is, I don't think we could look away. This community is beckoning for answers. Our community is beckoning for the real deal, for what life is really about. Because if you were to ask a random person, 8 out of 10 of them will say that there is something missing in their life, that there is a God-sized hole in every one of us. But see, this God-sized hole is not filled by what God gives. See, what God gives doesn't take the place of who God is. It never will. It's written all over the Bible. What you have will be taken away from you. You're not going to keep it. But what you will keep is knowing Jesus. What's going to go with you until the end of time is knowing Jesus. And it's not something that you can ever know fully. You're never going to take an SAT on Jesus. You're never going to be able to know fully what it is about Jesus. That's why the Bible calls it a mystery. Because little by little, Jesus' nature is being revealed. Little by little, we're knowing more and more of Jesus. Little by little, we're getting different revelations and grasps of Jesus' over-the-edge love for us. Let your fuel for living this life not become your future or what you're all about. Guys, I'm all about that. I'm all about us being provided for. And God is even more about that than you are. But see, the way we do it is more important than the destination. how we get there is more important of where we're going. See, how we get to the destination is way more important. If it's just by our striving and our doing and doing and doing and doing, you're going to get to a place in your life where you will be depressed, my friend. But if it's about knowing Jesus and letting Jesus will his purpose inside of you, letting Jesus will his calling inside of you, maybe it might start with breaking chains in your mind. You know, nobody here is meant to just be one thing. No, everybody here is multifaceted. God has big purposes for you that you're not just locked into one thing. You're not just locked into one place. God has such a big purpose with you that it goes beyond that. It's not about just getting for you and your family. It's about getting and getting and getting and getting more of Jesus and letting God use whatever you have for other people to know Jesus. And that's what church is all about. That's what Christianity is all about. And that's what it's always been about. Getting to know more of Jesus and letting that shape our everyday living. So I'm going to give each and every one of you guys an invitation. Gibb's going to sing this Good Good Father song. And as we sing this song, I just want to invite you to just worship with us. I want to invite you to take this time. If it's just a moment, let it be a moment. Just to get to know Jesus, just to know him in a deeper way. Let it be a moment just to deeply grasp who he is. Maybe it might be a moment for some of us to let go things that we've been holding on to. Maybe it might be a moment for some of us to let go of things that we've been trying to get on our own when God is just sitting there like, man, I want to do it with you. I want to work with you. I want you to work with me as well. So if you don't mind getting up out of your seat, if you want to just sit down, that's also fine, whatever you want to do. But we're just going to take a moment to worship and just worship God right now and just take this time to glean from him. Amen.